the University of the Western Cape, and I am exploring a very important issue, whether or not biofuels are a reasonable substitute for fossil fuels. Arguments will be made for and against this controversial topic, and conclusions shall be drawn at the end of the presentation.
What are biofuels? A biofuel is a fuel that contains energy from a geologically recent carbon fixation. These fuels are produced from living organisms. Examples of this carbon fixation occur in plants and microalgae. This biomass can be converted to convenient energy-containing substances in three different ways: thermal conversion, chemical conversion, and biochemical conversion.
When biofuel crops are grown in appropriate places and under sustainable conditions, they offer a host of benefits: reduced fossil fuel use, diversified fuel supplies, increased employment, decreased greenhouse gas emissions, enhanced habitat for wildlife, improved soil and water quality, and more stable global land use, thereby reducing pressure to clear new land. Not only have many criticisms of biofuels been alarmist, many have been simply inaccurate. Within 2007 and early 2008, for example, a bumper crop of media articles blamed sharply higher food prices worldwide on production of biofuels, particularly ethanol from corn within the United States. Subsequent studies, however, have shown that increases in food prices were primarily due to many other interacting factors, such as increased demand in emerging economies, soaring energy prices, drought in food exporting countries, cut-off in grain exports by major suppliers, market distorting subsidies, a tumbling US dollar, and speculation in commodity markets. Biofuels done right. With the right policy framework, cellulosic biofuel crops could offer an alternative that diversifies and boosts rural incomes based on perennials. Such a scenario would create incentives to reduce intentional burning that currently affects millions of acres worldwide each year. Perennial biofuel crops can help stabilize land cover, enhance soil carbon sequestration, provide habitat to support biodiversity, and improve soil water quality. Furthermore, they can reduce pressure to clear new land via improved incomes and yields. Developing countries have huge opportunities to increase crop yield and thereby grow more food on less land, given that cereal yields in less developed nations are 30% of those in North America. Hence, policy supporting biofuel production may actually help stop the intensive slash and burn agricultural cycle that contributes to greenhouse gas emissions, deforestation, land degradation, and a lifestyle that fails to support farmers and their families. Biofuels alone are not the solution. However, governments in the United States and elsewhere will have to develop and support a number of programs designed to support sustainable development. The operation and the rules of such programs must be transparent so that everyone can understand them and see that fair play is good. Among other attributes, the programs must offer economic incentives for sustainable production, and they must provide for secure land tenure and participatory land use planning. In this regard, pilot biofuel projects in Africa and Brazil are showing promise in addressing the vexing and difficult challenges of sustainable land use and development. Biofuels also are uniting diverse stockholders in a global movement to develop sustainability. Metrics and certification methods applicable to the broader agricultural sector. Given a priority to protect biodiversity and ecosystem services, it is important to further explore the drivers for the conversion of land at the frontier and to consider the effects, positive and negative, that US biofuel policies could have in these areas. This means it is crucial to distinguish between valid concerns calling for caution and alarmist criticisms that attribute complex problems solely to biofuels. Still, based on the analysis that we and others have done, we believe that biofuels developed in an economically and environmentally sustainable way can contribute significantly to the nation's, indeed the world's, energy security, while providing a host of benefits for many people in many regions. Now I will be making the transition to investigating why biofuel is not a suitable replacement for the fossil fuels. Biomass is a natural material, mostly trees, grasses, forestry waste, and agricultural waste that can be burned as a source of heat and for generating electricity. In the US, biomass accounts for a little less than 1% of the electricity supply. Firewood is a classic example of biomass, but biomass is finding more exotic uses too, for instance as a feedstock for ethanol and biodiesel. Biomass is a renewable energy source that is carbon neutral, since the CO2 released by burning or otherwise consuming it is recaptured by next year's crop. All that sounds great, right? Yes, but the Earth Talk piece mentions one potential problem with biomass. To be considered sustainable, biomass cannot be used faster than it grows back. That's a great point. Violating this rule is why so many villages in Africa have an ever-increasing barren ring around them, as villages venture further and further in their unsustainable quest to continue gathering more fuel wood than nature can grow back. But there are two other big flies in the biomass ointment that the Earth Talk piece overlooks that makes the sustainability of biomass at the large scale somewhat dubious. Number one, soil health. To do biomass in a truly sustainable manner, one must figure out how much wood crop residue or other usable material can be taken away without resulting in long-term degradation of soil quality. This is related to the not taking more than you can grow back issue, but it's important in its own right. Taking the entire crop from an area year after year to burn or convert into liquid biofuels leaves no decaying matter to feed the soil organisms that are essential to creating a healthy soil ecosystem. Healthy soil is essential to the long-term productivity of the growing operation, which brings us to the other major limitation. Number 2, net energy and internal inputs. Industrialized agriculture, which largely ignores true soil health, makes up for that deficiency by adding synthetic fertilizers, which are sourced from fossil fuels and other finite resources. This is the equivalent of a student over-consuming caffeine so he can stay up and cram the night before a big exam, or athletes using steroids to enhance performance. There is a notable short-term boost in performance, but in the long run, the method is unsustainable and utterly harmful if continued. As supplies of fossil fuels and other key inputs to industrial agriculture hit their production peaks, those inputs will become increasingly expensive and ultimately minimally available. We will then be limited to whatever nutrients can be regained using traditional methods, like cover cropping, manure from grazed animals, and waiting for more topsoil to form via weathering and biobreakdown of rock. Even though such methods produce the healthiest, most sustainable soil, they are comparatively slow. They don't give the quick productivity boost that most modern agriculture operations have become so reliant on. Without the external inputs, today's biomass operations aren't likely to look so appealing, and they certainly won't scale up to replace any significant percentage of our soon-to-be declining fossil fuels. Biomass and sustainability. Is there such a thing as sustainable biomass? Soil health is an issue that is routinely ignored in the current rah-rah coverage of ethanol, biodiesel and biomass. Grinning Planet is in favor of pursuing these energy sources sustainably, but pursuing them in an unsustainable manner merely trades our current bad energy approach for a different bad energy approach and keeps us on the road to agricultural ruin. As for net energy, also called energy return or energy invested, it is the key to why none of the wannabe energy solutions are as good as oil from an energy profit standpoint. Oil is king when it comes to net energy. Remember that petroleum, as well as coal and natural gas, are essentially concentrated ancient sunlight. Things grew and died, collected, heated, and compacted over millions of years, and ultimately became fossil fuels. On such a geological scale, all biofuels, including biomass, are essentially grown and used in real time, with no bank of previously stored inputs providing a free energy bonus. Net energy numbers. The energy returned on energy invested for US source petroleum is estimated to be somewhere between 5 and 10. The energy return on energy invested for corn sourced ethanol is less than 2 and probably closer to 1 when all imports are correctly accounted for. That sort of shortfall is a big problem as we head into a future of constrained petroleum supplies. The marginal energy return on energy invested of biofuels is why there is no possibility that they can be scaled up to replace any significant portion of petroleum at today's level of energy use. Don't get me wrong, Grinning Planet is no fan of oil. Its reign is coming to a close, and it's imperative that we leave oil before it leaves us. Quoted by Richard Heinberg. But all the happy talk about petroleum alternative needs to be examined under cold hard light of net energy, with the sustainability of each biomass approach verified, to know whether the promises are real or whether biomass is just